Global warming has reduced ice coverage in the Arctic region by as much as 40% in the last century, and the Arctic Ocean is reduced to potential fishing grounds. Representatives from 9 countries aim to meet to discuss exploratory fishing in the Arctic Ocean based on similar treaties covering other regions, starting out with rules on exploratory fishing as early as 2023. As the warming climate is opening up the Arctic for shipping, fishing, drilling, and mining, Russia has beefed up its military presence there, and the United States is carrying out more naval exercises. Russian Foreign Minister Sergei Lavrov lately urged Arctic states to resume high-level military meetings amid growing tension in the region. NATO has also increased its military activity in the Arctic. The latest UN report revealed the warming is getting worse than at the time of the 2015 Paris Agreement. Places will get hit by multiple climate disasters at once. It is a code red for humanity now. If the world warms one more degree Celsius, the kind of heat wave that used to happen only once every 50 years will happen twice every 7 years. Cutting levels of methane and CO2 emissions could help curb the warming in a short term.
Hello, I'm Wade Lee. Thanks for joining us on this week's Funday News. Here are your top stories. Extreme weather has become the norm in the past couple of months around the globe. Yet the effects are still, as ever, devastating. One of the leading causes is the effects of global warming, which is believed to reduce the ice coverage in the Arctic region by as much as 40%. As a result, potential fishing grounds have thus expanded in the Arctic. The US, China, Japan, Russia, and other countries are planning to conduct joint research in the Arctic Ocean, and a step forward to establishing fishing rules and regulations within the region.
The US, China, and Russia are the three most influential players in the Arctic region. As potential fishing grounds expand, it has become imperative to spell out rules to prevent unchecked fishing, Nikkei Asia reports. The joint research aims to track the types of fish in the Arctic and catch levels through exploratory fishing and share data. If a fish stock is deemed sufficient, members will discuss a framework to allow commercial fishing within limits. The members, which also include Canada, Japan, Denmark, Norway, Iceland, and South Korea, will discuss setting up a body to manage resources to enable monitoring for unchecked fishing and settle fishing disputes. Nikkei Asia reports, the goal is to establish those international rules by 2023-2024.
Other than the fishing potential, a warming climate is opening up the Arctic for shipping, drilling, and mining. A turf war has actually silently been waged by the superpowers of the world, as the Arctic is increasingly viewed as the arena for geopolitical competition amongst the United States, Russia, and China. As an Arctic state, by virtue of Alaska, the U.S. issued a comprehensive plan on August 4th, listing its strategies for the melting Arctic, including fishery, commercial transportation, oil and mineral explorations, protective species, and indigenous people. Russia and China are sure to have their own objectives going forward.
Since the Arctic lacks global rules like the Antarctic Treaty, countries are vying to tap its rich resources, including oil, natural gas, and rare minerals. China issued its first white paper on Arctic policy in 2018, unveiling plans to develop a sea lane dubbed the Ice Silk Road. Under a 5-year plan, China also signaled its intention to intensify resource development. China is already planning a rare earth mining project in Greenland, a move that has prompted local backlash. Russia, which has the largest territory within the Arctic, launched a liquefied natural gas project in the Yamal Peninsula in Siberia in 2017. To open up more sea lanes, it is building large-scale icebreakers as well. Russia's massive Arctic military drills in the spring this year raised alarm among U.S. officials.
So, just how exactly are China, Japan, South Korea amongst the group to research fishing treaties in the Arctic? Well, in 2013, at the 8th ministerial meeting of the Arctic Council in Kiruna, Sweden, 5 Asian states, including China, India, Japan, South Korea, and Singapore, along with Italy, were received as observers due to the fast pace of changing that's happening in the Arctic. This ministerial meeting echoed and amplified the main challenges we currently face and received observed member countries to increase the significance of the subject.
Although China is a non-Arctic state, in January 2018, it released a white paper on China's Arctic policy that refers to China as a near-Arctic state, because China's northernmost territory, northeast of Mongolia, is at about the same latitude as the Aleutian Islands in Alaska, which the United States includes in its definition of the Arctic for purposes of the U.S. law. And China's white paper refers to trans-Arctic shipping routes as the Polar Silk Road and identifies these routes as a third major transportation corridor for the Belt and Road Initiative. It's China's major geopolitical initiative, first announced by China in 2013, to knit Eurasia and other regions. The polar regions, both the Arctic and Antarctic, are included in China's 14th five-year plan, covering the period between 2021 and 2025.
China isn't the only country that seeks to take advantage of the Arctic. Russia, with the largest landmass in the Arctic region, seeks to solidify its claim. On May 20, 2021, Russian Foreign Minister Sergei Lavrov urges Arctic states to resume high-level military meeting amid growing tensions in the region and expressed concerns about the deployment of foreign troops in Norway near the Russian border. He questioned NATO's motive in deploying bombers and submarines to the area, while U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken voiced alarms at Russia's military buildup in the Arctic region on the very same day.
Although Russia is pushing for Arctic states to resume high-level military meetings amid growing tension in the region, this move is opposed by Washington. Yet the reason why the annual meetings between armed forces chiefs from Arctic states were halted in 2014 was following Russia's annexation of Crimea. Russia has significantly expanded its military bases in the Arctic region in recent years. The Nagurskoye base in Franz Josef Land, Moscow's northernmost military base, lying just 1,000 kilometers from the North Pole, can handle nuclear-capable strategic bombers. NATO has also increased its military activity in the Arctic. U.S. Air Force B-1B bombers have been training with Norwegian Air Force F-35A jets in recent months, and the U.S. is building facilities at 3 Norwegian airfields and a naval base.
Climate change has changed the geopolitical situation in the Arctic. Though world leaders have previously agreed to limit global warming to 1.5 degrees Celsius following the 2015 Paris Climate Agreement, a new UN report found that goal may be impossible. By 2040, Earth will warm at least by that much. According to an authoritative intergovernmental panel on climate change report, released on August 9, 2021, shows the world has already warmed by nearly 1.1 degrees Celsius since 2015. The United Nations called the condition now a code red for humanity, since we have nowhere to run and nowhere to hide.
The 3,000-plus-page United Nations report from 234 scientists said warming is already accelerating sea level rise and worsening extremes such as heat waves, droughts, floods, and storms. Tropical cyclones are getting stronger and wetter, while Arctic sea ice is dwindling in the summer and permafrost is thawing. All of these trends will get worse. For example, the kind of heat wave that used to happen only once every 50 years now happens once a decade, and if the world warms one more degree Celsius, it will happen twice every 7 years.
Reports show that as the planet warms, multiple locations will simultaneously be affected by numerous climate disasters. This can be seen in the many countries across the globe, where heat waves, droughts, and wildfire are causing horrific damage. Despite this, UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres still clings on to hope that world leaders could still unite together and prevent the 1.5 degree warming.
As a new move, scientists emphasized how cutting airborne levels of methane could help curb short-term warming. Lots of methane in the atmosphere comes from leaks of natural gas, a major power source. Livestock also produces large amounts of the gas, a good chunk of it in cattle burps. More than 100 countries have made informal pledges to achieve net zero human-caused carbon dioxide emissions sometime around mid-century. The report said those commitments are essential. It is still possible to forestall many of the most dire impacts.
And that's all the time we have for today. Thanks for joining us on Fun Day News. Let's make every day a fun day. I'm Wade Lee, your host, and I'll see you next time.